coming in a little bit.
Morning, Wendell.
It's interesting. It was plugged in, but it must not have been making a full connection to the whole this morning. And I didn't even charge it on. I had to wire it 30%. So.
I just can't even get it out. So I'm guessing I'm really simple.
Can't you see that it's just raining? There ain't no need to go outside. But baby, you hardly even know when I try to show you. Song is meant to be doing what you're supposed to. Waking up, maybe we could sleep. Make you banana pancakes, pretend like it's the weekend now. No need, ain't no need. Can't you see, rain all day and I don't mind. But the telephone singing, ringing, it's too early, don't pick it up. We don't. Just so can't you see that it's just raining? There ain't no need to go outside. But baby, you hardly even know when I try to show you the song is meant to be.
Well, give me the sign. Hello. Hey, James. Hey, James. Are they saying wait? Go. Good morning, Grace Church. How are you this nice autumn day? We're blessed not to be in a hurricane. I'd like to thank everybody to come out to worship with us. Those who are in the parking lot can turn to 90.7 on the radio. For those at home can see us on YouTube live stream. If you're new to visiting us, we have yellow cards in the pew to turn in to the ushers. We also have prayer requests. This has been going on for more than half a century. Every week, we pray on Monday for the names that turned in. We pray a week for them. So, welcome to Grace.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
It is always a great joy to be with you on each Sunday morning. It is also a great joy to be in a congregation that we're pretty busy. And because we're pretty busy, we have groups that are using us, we have weddings, we have everything, and things are going on. And then on Sunday morning, sometimes we have to try to figure out how to reconfigure stuff. So somebody's probably like, well, why is the Christ candle all the way over there? And why is it not lit? Because there was a wedding here yesterday. And so everything wasn't put back. And so, you know, so, but that's one of the things that we get to enjoy. about being the church, and being the church that's identified, and being even more identified as the community church. Because even this afternoon, when we're finished worshiping here, there's a group that's having a meeting this afternoon at 3 p.m. And so we're constantly having things happen and going. On last evening, we had a break-in. Actually, it was this morning about 5-something. I got the call at 5-something this morning. A break-in into the kitchen. And so there's not very much that someone could actually take out of the kitchen. And so the refrigerators and freezers are locked. But then we have to kind of wonder, what was that about? Is it about somebody who actually is hungry, or just someone who is vandalizing the place? But we live in the midst of all of that, and we bring all of that to worship with us, because we are the community church. And so even as we participate in our tradition, in our tradition of bringing a gift before the Almighty God, we know we don't only bring a monetary gift, but we bring all that we are to the Almighty God. Our joys, our concerns, because God is big enough to handle all of them. Let us pray together this morning. Our offertory prayer. Gracious and giving God, we bring our tithes and offerings to you this day and pray that as we give them, that you will kindle in us a deeper faith and a stronger commitment. We acknowledge that some of us have found our way back to you on our own. Others of us have lived into a faith that's around us from the time we were born, lived out in parents, grandparents, siblings, and spouse. However, this faith found its way to our hearts and to our DNA. Help us kindle it to flame, that the world might be set on fire with your love and compassion. In Jesus Christ we pray, amen.
No one stands alone, we're stands alone.
Amen. Let us stand and receive our offering with the doxology, and we will remain standing for our call to worship and our first hymn of the day. God transforms enemies into sisters and brothers.
We gather as God's people, hungering for healing and hope, knowing that even when life is no picnic,
God prepares a feast for us. Table of grace. This is God's table, it's not yours or mine. Come to the table of grace. Come to the table of grace. Come to the table of peace. Table is not yours or mine. Come to the table of peace. Come to the table of love. Come to the table of love. This is God's table, it's not yours or mine. Come to the table of love. Come to the table of joy. Come to the table of joy. This is God's table, it's not yours or mine. Come to the table of joy. Amen. You may be seated. Today we know it's First Sunday, but it's not only just First Sunday and Communion Sunday for us, but all around the world, people are participating in Holy Communion as a part of worship today. And so we are excited to participate in this celebration as God's children here at Grace United Methodist Church. But today, children, the thing I want to really talk to you about is faith. And how do we get faith? And how faith is passed down. Now, some of us, we have been raised in households, and we have grandmothers, and we have grandfathers, and they've taught us a lot about God, and so they've passed their faith on to us. Now, some of us, we may just have had a family friend who invited us to Bible study or vacation Bible school, or some of the fun things we do at Grace, and that may have been our first encounter with thinking about faith. But no matter how you came to faith, whether this is your first day or whether you've always been raised with a family that has brought you to church and talk about God. Whenever you come, we're all invited to the table. And that's the song this morning. Come to the table of grace. Come to the table of love. Come to the table of peace. Because in our tradition, what we really believe is that in Holy Communion, we have an opportunity to meet with God. That as a part of the sacrifice, that we have an opportunity to repent. And repent is just when we turn from our ways. We turn from our ways and we turn to God. We have an opportunity for justification. And justification is when things are made right. And that even in communion, we realize that we're being made right with God. That it is a gift. So today we ask that you will just begin that journey of faith with us if you haven't started it already. And in that journey of faith, we want to let you know when you start to believe and you start to do the things that God desires for us to do, something happens. Something happens inside of us, not just on the outside. And that thing that happens is that the Holy Spirit starts to grow and expand and teach us. And that the love that's in our heart starts to grow and expand. I like to think about it kind of like the Grinch who stole Christmas. And I'm dating myself because some of you may be like, Pastor, who is the Grinch? But they play it every year. And how his heart was so small. And you remember when he took everything from the village? And his heart was just so small. And then that day, how it grew and how it expanded, and it burst even out of the little square that they showed on TV, you know, where his heart was. And I see grace and love of God like that, that as we participate in love and share love with each other, there is something that happens in the midst of community, and that love grows larger and larger and larger and expands. So today, when we come to the communion table, we're participating in a gift of love and also as a community saying that we will love and care for each other. May your faith continue to grow because it's even promised that if we have faith the size of a mustard seed, that we can do great things. The scriptures say that we can tell a mountain to move. Now, that's kind of out there. But if we do have faith and we share our faith with others, we can cause many things in our atmosphere to move and in our world to move because love wins and faith is love. Amen.
In thy pure fire.
Holy Spirit, power divine, fill and nerve this will of mine. Grant that I may strongly live, bravely bear, and nobly strive. Holy Spirit, right divine, King within my conscience reign, to be my Lord, and I shall be firmly bound forever free. You may be seated.
These are the words of Paul. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the command of God our Savior and Jesus Christ our hope, to Timothy, my loyal child in the faith. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I urge you, as I did when I was on my way to Macedonia, to remain in Ephesus so that you may instruct certain people not to teach any different doctrine, and not to occupy themselves with myths and endless genealogies that promote speculations rather than the divine training that is known by faith. But the aim of such instruction is love that comes from a pure heart, a good conscience, and sincere faith. Some people have deviated from these and turned to meaningless talk, desiring to be teachers of the law, without understanding either what they are saying or the things about which they make assertions. Now, we know that the law is good if one uses it legitimately. This means understanding that the law is laid down not for the innocent, but for the profane, for the lawless and disobedient, for the godless and sinful, for the unholy, for those who kill their father or mother, for murderers, fornicators, sodomites, slave traders, liars, perjurers, and for whatever else is contrary to the sound teaching that conforms to the glorious gospel of the blessed God, which God has entrusted to me. I am grateful to Jesus Christ our Lord, who has strengthened me because God judged me faithful and appointed me to God's service, even though I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, a man of violence. But I received mercy because I acted ignorantly in unbelief, and the grace of our Lord overflowed for me with the faith and love that are in Christ Jesus.
Now apostles said to the Lord, increase our faith. The Lord replied to them, if you had faith only the size of this mulberry tree, you could command it, the size of a mustard seed, you could command this mulberry tree to uproot itself and plant itself in the sea, and it would obey you. Who among you, seeing that your slave had just come in after a day of plowing and tending the sheep in the field, would say to the slave, come and take your place at the table with me. Would you not rather say, prepare supper for me, and put on your apron, and serve me, while I eat and drink? You can eat and drink later. And then, would you thank the slave for doing what was commanded? So you also, when you have done only what you were ordered to do, say, we are worthless slaves. We have done only what we ought to have done. The Gospel according to Luke. The Word of God for all people.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
Die. Oh, when I come to die, oh, when I come to die, give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. Nobody but Jesus. World, you can forgive me, Jesus.
Yes. You may have all this world, but give me Jesus. Give me Jesus. The songwriter wrote, something within me that holdeth the reins. Something within me that banishes pain. Something within me I cannot explain. All that I know, there is something within. Preachers and teachers would make their appeal, fighting as soldiers on great battlefields, when to their pleadings my poor heart did yield. All I can say, there is something within. Then he went on to ask those who were listening, have you that something, that burning desire? Have you that something that never doth tire? Oh, if you have it, that heavenly fire, then let the world know there is something within. I met God one morn, my soul feeling bad, heart heavy laden, with a bowed down head. He lifted my burden, made me so glad. All that I know is that there is something within. Something within me that holdeth the reins, something within me that banishes pain, something within me I cannot explain. All that I know is that there's something within. Let us pray. Holy something. Holy something that is within us. That something within us that holdeth the rain. Holy something within us. We humble ourselves in the presence of the Almighty God, who through Jesus Christ, our brother, promised to send to us a comforter, to send to us the Holy Spirit, to send to us the something within that we do not understand and that we cannot explain. But Lord God, we're so grateful that it makes us love our enemy, and it makes us love our friend, and it won't let us be ashamed to tell the world that I've been born again. Now, after carefully crafting a sermon, I decided I was not going to use it. And that's kind of dangerous. Let me see what time it is. It's 11:06, and we still will get out on time. Because if I'm chasing too many rabbit trails, just say, Pastor, we got to go. Now, it is amazing, the story from the epistle. And rather, we believe that it's actually Paul who pens the letter, or someone else in Paul's name. I think that's not relevant. But I think we should hear the invitation that is extended to Paul, protege, his disciple. Because Paul extends an invitation to him to come and suffer with me. Now, I don't know how many of us would want that kind of invitation. To come and suffer with me. And Paul is inviting him to come and suffer for the sake of the gospel. And I know for us, sometimes we can't receive that concept because we live in a country where we have the freedom to worship and we have the freedom to celebrate God and to come to church. But in that setting, it was dangerous to follow this new way. This way of Jesus Christ, this way that Paul is inviting his young disciple into, Timothy. Because in this way of living, you are going to be persecuted. In this way of living, you are going to be asked to do what people around you were not doing. You are going to be asked to live differently and to live into a different concept of what it means to be a part of the unfolding kingdom of God. So we have Paul inviting Timothy to suffer. And I know a lot of times when we hear that, we want to think about our suffering and the way the world suffers, but that's not what Timothy is getting at. Because we all suffer tragedy. We all suffer defeat. We all get disappointed sometimes. All of those things happen to us, and they're just something that happens to everyone in the world. But Paul is inviting Timothy into the ministry that will require faith. And he knew that Timothy had been brought up in the faith. And Paul is saying, stir up the gift within you because you need a gift stirred up inside of you to be able to sustain in ministry and the kind of ministry I am inviting you into and what God is inviting you into. And I think that is true even for grace today, that we must stir up the gift. I know many of you are not even aware of the kind of calls we get during the week. Calls from people who feel that we're tearing down their memories. We're destroying what they built. We got a call, one call this week that said, I can't believe y'all let prisoners come to church. I'm glad Jackie took the call. She didn't pass it on to me. The staff, they're kind of smart about that kind of stuff, what to pass on to me and not to pass on to me. And Jackie said, ma'am, we don't let prisoners come to church. We go to the prison. And we write letters to the prison. But the people who come to church, they used to be in prison, but now they're returning citizens. And they are a part of our church. But I'm going to tell you, we have some good staff because Jackie even went on to be invitational like Timothy. Jackie said, "Why won't you come and go to the prison with me? Why won't you come and suffer with me? Why won't you come and take this burden on? Why won't you lay a part of your life down to serve someone else? Why won't you bring forgiveness in the midst of your judgment? Why won't you come and journey with us?" Because Jackie did say that about, well, the other thing that you can do, because you used to be a member here, you can come and support us. And I bring up that story to say, grace, in the midst of our doing, we're going to find criticism. In the midst of our being, in the midst of our existence, in the midst of us stepping out in faith and becoming who we think God is calling us to be, we're going to have some who will turn their backs on us, which they've already have. But the word may feel damaging to us, and it may hurt us in some kind of way. So that's more of what Paul is telling Timothy. When you come and step into this ministry, Timothy, there are some things that God is going to ask you to do and require you to do that you wouldn't want to do on your own, and that people are going to question. Can't you imagine Ananias when he was minding his own business and God decided that he was going to call Paul? Minding his own business, and this dude that was killing people who were practicing the way, that Ananias, God tells him to go to Saul. That's about crazy. Because Ananias is like, no, he's a bad dude. He kills folk. He's killing us. But God asked Ananias to take that quantum leap, to be God in the midst of a situation that he had already prejudged as dangerous. Yes, we're invited by Jesus Christ to take up our cross and follow him. Church, I'm going to tell you, your headache is not your cross. That's just a headache. Injury is not your cross. Your cross is when you take up the message of Jesus and you take it everywhere you go, because there is something within you. Something within you that becomes uncomfortable when you see the suffering of others. And when you imagine others being lost, that there is something within you, and if that something within you doesn't get agitated, I'm going to ask you to stir up the gift. Stir up your faith. Because your faith will take you to unimaginable spaces. Not necessarily because you desire to go there, but because God wants you there. So Jesus, talking to his disciples, in the gospel lesson patches, I love the first part of it. But as we got to the second part of it, I was like, is Jesus having a bad day? But then I'm going to tell you my interpretation, and this is eisegesis. I'm not basing it on any scholarship or what anybody else said. I think Jesus was saying, this is how you all behave. I don't think he was saying that this is the appropriate way to behave, but I think he was saying, this is how you all behave. So I'm going to take your behavior and what you do, even with those who are under your rule, that you don't come and invite them to the table with you. But you tell them to prepare for you. First, take care of your needs. And then after that, then they're able to take care of their needs. And then you're like, okay, you've done nothing great because you've only done what's required of you. And so as I kind of wrestled with that, I was like, well, Lord, because your actions was that you came to serve. That you came to serve. And then you ask us to take up our cross and follow you. So you've asked us to serve. And so when you ask us to serve, when we do what is required of us, there's no need for us to expect a big applause. I like award ceremonies. I don't look at any of them anymore, but I used to love to look at them. Everybody there wants to be recognized and applauded for their work. And so many times on the battlefield and doing the work of Christ, sometimes we get into ourselves and we want to be applauded for our work. And if no applause comes, we're disappointed. Well, church, I'm going to tell you today that anything you do for Christ will last. That anything you do for Christ will last. And when you do it, it's the minimum requirement of love. It's the minimum requirement of love. So in all our doing, we may not get an applause. We may not get a thank you. But if we behave like Jesus, I promise you, we will see change. I just invite you today to stir up the gift. To stir up the gift that is inside of you. For in this gift, you will find joy. In this gift, you will find life. In this gift, you will find love and grace and peace. Now, those are some nice words, but I'm going to tell you that operating in your gift sometimes may mean that you have to walk through hell to do what God has called you to do. But the agitation of the gift, the agitation of your faith, will empower you to move forward and to continue to go, to live, and to give. Let us continue our worship. With Holy Communion. I remind you that communion is an act of confession within itself. As we have told the children this morning, church, the Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth. You have made from one every nation and people to live on all the faces of the earth. And so, with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna. In the highest. Holy are you and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church. Deliver us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. He commissioned us to be his witness to the ends of the earth and to make disciples of all nations. And today his family and all the world is joining at his holy table. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took bread. He gave thanks to you. He broke the bread. And he gave it to his disciples and said, "Eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And likewise, when the supper was over, he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples and said, "Drink from this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." And in remembrance of these, your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's offering for us as we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on us gathered here and on these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and blood of Christ, that we may be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. renew our communion with your church throughout the world, and strengthen it in every nation among every people to witness faithfully in your name. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. Now, with the confidence of children of the Almighty God, let us pray together the New Zealand prayer version of our Lord's Prayer. Eternal Spirit, Earth Maker, Pain Bearer, Life Giver, Source of all that is and that shall be, Father and Mother of us all, loving God in whom there is heaven, the hallowing of your name echo throughout the universe, the way of justice is and followed by the principles of this world. Your commonwealth of peace and freedom sustain our hope and come on earth. With the bread we feed us, in the hurts we absorb from one another, forgive us. In times of temptation and test, strengthen us. From trial too great to endure, spare us. From the grip of all that is evil, free us. From your reign in the glory of the power that is love, now and forever. Amen. In our tradition, we have open communion. That means that all who are present, you're welcome to participate as a part of the gift, this sacrament, to the church. We simply ask that you examine your very own heart. Examine it to see whether you are willing to follow the commandments of God, to love your neighbor, to be in love and charity with everyone. We're going to have the ushers come forward to pass out the elements, and we will hold on to them, and then we will have them together. if you would take the bread that represents for us, the body of Christ that was given for us, take and eat. The cup, the juice, represents the blood of Christ that was shed for us. Shed for the sins of the entire world. Take ye and drink ye all of this. You have demonstrated by your participation that indeed you are in love and charity with your neighbors, and that you have the intent of leading a new life, following the commandments of God, that we find fulfilled in the life of Jesus the Christ. Amen. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. My brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Hallelujah, not my brother, not my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Oh, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Hallelujah, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher, not the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Hallelujah, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Standing in the need of prayer. Not my father, not my mother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Hallelujah, it's me, it's me, it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. I ask you to receive this benediction as you go from here. May God, the Father in Christ, Jesus our Lord, give you grace, mercy, and peace. Do not let your faith or your witness grow cold. Remember God's gift of faith. It's like a flame. When the embers of the flame have cooled, you must fan them again to keep them ablaze. So remember what you have been taught and what you have experienced. Live in such a way that all who know you may see the light of God reflected in you. And may the grace of God, the love of Jesus Christ, and the presence of the Holy Spirit be with you and among you in the days ahead. Amen.